We have to protect the rights of all our athletes to compete. But we also have to protect competitive fairness at our events.
With a 71% majority vote, the historic decision was made. Swimming's world governing body, FINA, moving to restrict transgender athletes from participating in elite women's competition.
If inclusion is one of the cornerstones of sport, then the other would be fairness.
The only exception, if athletes transitioned before male puberty or the age of 12, whichever is later.
The medical advice is that people who are considering transitioning shouldn't do that before they're 14 years of age. And yet the FINA ruling, in effect, means that you've got 10-year-olds or younger that are having to make decisions about their adult competitive sport life.
FINA's plan to create an open category for trans athletes, no consolation for the trans community and its supporters.
I think a policy that is trying to be fair to all participants in aquatic sports is in fact being exclusionary.
The FINA response is to a problem that doesn't exist because we don't see athletes up on the Olympic podium or at World Championships. What we have seen is one athlete in a college level competition win one race.
That one athlete is American swimmer Leah Thomas, who earlier this year became the first known transgender athlete to win a national college title.
Thomas wins the NCAA championship.
Her Olympic dreams now in tatters. Some of Australia's top swimmers have supported the decision.
I'm just thankful that finally we have a decision, we have a direction we're going.
It pains me that this part of my role may injure, infuriate and potentially alienate people from an already marginalised trans community.
Aussie flag bearer Cate Campbell's FINA address triggering a backlash from former teammate Maddie Groves, who tweeted,
"You're okay with ostracising an already marginalised group? Real accepting. Shame on everyone that supported this discriminatory and unscientific decision."
FINA, though, argues there's nothing unscientific about it. Members hearing a report from a transgender task force of medical, legal and sports figures before the vote.
It is a policy that is based on science.
Listen to the science and experts.
The transgender community is so tiny, and then the community that wants to compete at the elite level in any sport is even tinier. So the pool of people from a scientific perspective in order to be able to understand what competitive advantage looks like is so minute that the science, I think, just doesn't stack up, which is perhaps why we're not seeing it and they're just not being transparent.
Other sports now expected to follow suit after swimming's landmark decision.
We need to remember that it doesn't exist in a vacuum. The negative consequences of policies such as this is that the wider community often feel like they can put their two cents in with their, you know, opinions of trans people, and it can have a real life effect on the trans and gender diverse community.
Transgender athlete Hannah Mouncey is an international handballer and Australian rules footballer and joins us now. Hannah, what did you make of FINA's decision?
Look, it was an interesting one. Sort of came from nowhere. Normally you hear about these things a bit beforehand, but a blanket ban is very, very strong and I think really unnecessary because it's painting something which a lot of people have acknowledged is a very grey area and decided that it's black and white. And it's a really difficult place to be in, particularly deciding that basically if you haven't transitioned by the time you're 12, you can't compete. All I can say is it's interesting. It's not great.
Not quite a blanket ban because, as you say, there's the 12-year-old limit. And also they're proposing to create an open category for trans athletes. Do you have any idea how that would work?
I don't think it would work, if I'm honest. And part of the reason is if it's an open category, I don't know that trans people are actually going to be able to compete, for one, because all that's going to happen is, say, for example, you know, Australia has first and second qualify for the 100 metres at our national championships. They're just going to send third and fourth and compete in that. I mean, that's what I would do. But also, trans athletes, you know, who are they going to compete against? There's not that many of us. Trans people have been really, really made to feel as though sport's not a welcoming space for the last, you know, for as long as we've been around, really. And so I don't know in this instance, Leah Thomas, who I'm sure, you know, let's not beat around the bush, that's who this ruling is there for. She's not going to have anyone to compete against in all likelihood. So there's a lot of reasons why it wouldn't work, but those two are the two that stand out to me.
So Hannah, FINA says this is based on fairness and on the science. Do you accept that a trans athlete does have an advantage over other competitors?
No, not at all. And I think people... Look, the thing with this debate, and it shouldn't even be a debate, is it's been very politicised. If it came down to the actual science of it, there'd be no debate and trans people would be competing. And you can look at the IAAF and what they've done. And, you know, they did research into testosterone deprivation in regards to Caster Semenya, who's intersex. And what they came back with was that testosterone deprivation provided such an impact on her performance that they essentially said to her, you know, if you want to run, you've got to lower your testosterone, but then you're fine. The same research, if you apply it to trans people, they turn around and say the data isn't in.
Well, that takes us to the athletes themselves. Cate Campbell, who we'll speak to a little later, she was the flag bearer, Australian champion swimmer. She herself says that she believes this decision's the right decision. When it comes from the athletes, does that make a difference for you?
It doesn't, because I would ask how much they actually know about what happens to a trans person's body when they go through a transition process. And also in regards to Cate and the swimmers as well, I actually, during the election, because they were obviously asked a lot, I reached out to a mutual contact of both of ours and offered to speak to any of them to know more. That offer was never taken up, so I don't know, you know, exactly who Cate's spoken to, but I think it would really help speaking to athletes who have been through it. Trans people are never included in the discussion, really, when it comes to policy debate or anything like that. And so until we are, you know, athletes who, look, are excellent at what they do and are being asked for an opinion, but I don't think they really know what they're talking about a lot of the time, and nor should they. You know, if I wasn't trans, I wouldn't know what I'm talking about either. And that's not an expectation on anyone. But I think we need to take it with a grain of salt when we listen to those sort of opinions.
You seem fairly certain in your own mind on the biological or scientific argument. At the same time, you reference that bodies, some of the sporting bodies are saying the science isn't yet in. Why are you so certain if the science isn't in?
I've been through it. And I'm not saying that the science isn't in. The sporting bodies are. And I think that's a key difference. You know, for me, I can tell you, you know, at November 2015, before we went over to Qatar to compete at the Olympic qualifiers for handball, I was benching 150, squatting 200 and cleaning 140, and that's all kilos. Within 12 months, my bench press had gone down to about 60. The squat had gone down to about 70 and the clean had gone down to about 60 or 70 again. It's a pretty big drop in 12 months. But also, how do we apply any of this science, or how do we look at people's bodies? You know, I use myself as an example. I think it's on the record. I am, you know, 6'2", quite big. I'd be an awful gymnast and I'd be an awful marathon runner, an awful diver. So are we going to tell trans people that they can only play sports that they're not going to be good at? You know, it's a real problem. And I think we need to look at it as a whole and not look at it in such a simple way as we are at the moment.
Hannah, thanks very much for your time tonight. Appreciate it.
No worries at all.
Cate Campbell is an Olympic champion and Aussie flag bearer who, as we just heard, addressed the FINA meeting in Budapest overnight. She joins us now. Cate, you were clearly very emotional and considered about this. You said you had to wrestle with the issue. What ultimately convinced you to back this decision?
I want to be clear that my addressing the Congress last night wasn't about backing any decision or what I felt was the right thing to do. I think that a lot of athletes have been wanting a clear stance and a clear policy on this for a long time because both sides of the argument have been incredibly heated. I was in full support of the process. FINA went and they consulted the best medical and legal experts in the world. It was an incredibly inclusive process, and that was why I was there and asking the Congress to vote on a decision. They consulted, like I said, the best legal experts, but the best medical experts. And it's important that this policy is not based on what anyone felt was the right thing to do. It's not based on emotion. It is based on science and evidence. And I know that that's a really difficult thing to talk about because this issue talks about people and it talks about people's lives and it talks about their emotions and their emotional well-being and their states. But this policy has to draw a line at some point. So I was in full support of the process that went into developing this really rigorous policy.
We spoke earlier in the show to Hannah Mouncey, who's a transgender handballer and Australian rules footballer as well. She was very critical of the decision, but also just of the role that the science plays. She seems to have a view that the science is actually pretty settled that trans athletes don't have an advantage, and that a lot of what happens is that expert opinion is used and manipulated for political reasons to reach a conclusion that sporting bodies want to reach. So that's her perspective. Are you really confident in saying that that's not the case here, or does Hannah have a point?
I think that everyone is entitled to their opinion, and I sit here as someone who this policy does not affect. And so obviously my views will come at it from that perspective, and Hannah's will come at it from her perspective. But the science was irrefutable. It was really clear. It was presented by the leading experts in the world on differences in sex and the roles that sex play on physiological and biological performance. And the long-lasting legacy effects of high levels of testosterone, including bigger airways, bigger heart, stronger muscles, longer limbs, and even reducing levels of testosterone when you complete your transition, does not negate the advantages that they have over naturally born females.
Cate, FINA has come up with this idea of an open category. The trans community says, well, there wouldn't be enough people to compete in that open category. So who would actually be swimming in those events?
I think that the open category is to allow people to swim in whatever gender they feel they identify with, and as many or as few people can do that as possible. And I think that it's really important to recognise with this policy is that we are talking about elite professional sport. This is not talking about community sport. This is not talking about club sport. This is not talking about amateur sport. The majority of athletes will only ever compete in amateur or community sport. As an Olympian, we make up 0.001% of the population. That is such a small minority. And I think that club and community sport has so many things to offer society. It offers inclusion, a place to be accepted, friends, community. It helps combat obesity and mental health problems. And in all of those areas, in all of those respects, people from the trans community and the gender diverse community will be and are accepted. I think that we really, really need to stress that. And I understand that this policy is going to affect very, very few people, but to not draw a line and to not make a stand is to allow this debate to continue and allow hurtful things to be said from both sides, and to do nothing. Also, and I realise that this may be really harsh, but it will negatively affect female athletes all around the world if we do not listen to science. And I want to stress that this policy was based on science and on evidence, not what people felt was the right thing to do, but what science told us was the right thing to do.
It's one of the thorniest issues you could speak to us about, Cate, so we appreciate you taking the time to do so. Thanks for your time.
Thank you so much.